We go to text number one. Shri Prahlad Uvacha Komara Acharit Pragyo Dharman Bhagavatan Hiya Dullabham Manusam Janma Tad Apyadruvam Atadam. You can repeat the translation some words at a time after me. I should have probably. Prahlad Maharaj said.
Prahlad Maharaj said.
One who is
sufficiently intelligent
should use the human form of body, from the very beginning of life.
In other words,
from the tender age of childhood, to practice the activities of devotional service,
giving up
all other engagements. The human body is most rarely achieved. And although temporary,
like other bodies,
it is meaningful. Because in human life,
one can perform
devotional service. Even a slight amount of sincere devotional service can give one complete perfection. Purport by Srila Prabhupada. The whole purpose of Vedic civilization and of reading the Vedas is to attain the perfect stage of devotional service in the human form of life. According to the Vedic system, therefore, from the very beginning of life, the Brahmacharya system is introduced so that from one's very childhood, from the age of 5 years, one can practice modifying one's human activities so as to engage perfectly and devotional service. As confirmed in Bhagavad Gita chapter 2 text 40, Svalpam apyasya dharmasya trayate mahato bhayat. Even a little advancement on this path can protect one from the most dangerous type of fear. Modern civilization, not referring to the Vedics of Vedic literature, is so cruel to the members of human society that instead of teaching children to become brahmacharis, it teaches mothers to kill the children even in the womb on the plea of curbing the increase of population. And if by chance a child is saved, he is educated only for sense gratification. Gradually, throughout the entire world, human society is losing interest in the perfection of life. Indeed, men are living like cats and dogs, spoiling the duration of the human lives by actually preparing to transmigrate again to the degraded species among the 8,400,000 forms of life. The Krishna consciousness movement is anxious to serve human society by teaching people to perform devotional service, which can save a human being from being degraded again to animal life. As already stated by Prahlad Maharaj, Bhagavat Dharma consists of Shravanam, Kirtanam Vishnu Smaranam, Padasevanam, Achanam, Vandanam Dasyam Sakyam, Atma Nivedanam. In all the schools, colleges and universities, and at home, all children and youths should be taught to hear about the Supreme Personality of Godhead. In other words, they should be taught to hear the instructions of Bhagavad Gita, to put them into practice in their lives, and thus to become strong in devotional service, free from fear of being degraded to animal life. Following Bhagavad Dharma,
Was this feeding back a little bit, Maharaj?
Now I have to stretch my voice. Following Bhagavad Dharma has been made extremely easy in this age of Kali. The Shastra says, Harinama, Harinama, Hariname Vakevalam, Kalo Nasteva, 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 Kakir Adyata. One need only chant the Hare Krishna Mahamantra. Everyone engaged in the practice of chanting the Hare Krishna Mahamantra will be completely cleansed from the core of his heart and be saved from the cycle of birth and death. The child, no matter what he or she does, from the birth till the prior to entering 5 years of age is not responsible and liable for their own actions. They don't get any reaction to their actions. The persons who actually suffer the reactions of the children or enjoy their pious reactions are the parents. Only after they turn 5+ do they go through their own course of the law of karma, of getting action and reaction. This is the natural law in the material world. Now, you know, when you see even 2 or 3 years of age, girl or boy, and you may take them on a Sunday, they may be your son or daughter, but you take them on a Sunday, say to Regent's Park, up the road. And, you know, you as the parent or the mother or the father, you know, you are completely aware of your surroundings. You know, there's other people in the park, you see people doing things and so forth. You see other children with their parents and other families. People are having a picnic basket, you're aware of it. But then you notice that your own little girl or little boy, below the age of 5, you know, they are running, you know, in the park, and they climb some tree and then so forth. But they are very, you could say in one sense, like an Atmanama's Chamunaya. In other words, they are like munis or rishis, that they are completely self-satisfied. You know, they will sing to themselves, you know. They won't walk, they will waltz, you know, they will dance from one place to another, see. And they are completely oblivious of any person that can be judgmental on their actions. They don't care, because they are not careless, but they are carefree. They are carefree. So that's the nature of the consciousness of the residents of this spiritual world, especially Goloka Vrindavan. They have no anxieties. They do not know, and they are not aware if there's any danger coming also. Because in the spiritual world there's no danger. It's fear. In the place is not fearless, the person, and neither the person knows what is fear. In the spiritual world there's no such thing as fear. It's unknown and unheard of, even in a knowledge-wise capacity. See? Yeah, we know what is being fearless and fearful, you know, but there is no such duality in the spiritual world. So the nature of such a consciousness is called the purity of innocence. The purity of innocence. Innocent means not contaminated. Innocent means not adulterated, not changed in any way. So all of us have experience, even with children at home, they won't walk from one room to another. See? They will dance, they will, you know, they'll dance. You see children, you know, they won't walk, they'll dance. See? So this is called Natyam. Natyam means every, you know, step is a dance. Mm-hmm. And when that little boy or girl below the age of 5 if they want to address the mother, they don't say ma or mummy. You know, they'll sing it, and they'll say mama, papa, you know, they sing. So kata gana, every word is a song, and every step is a dance. Kata gana natyam gamanam. That's the children, you see them. Above the age of 5 years, they become contaminated. They lose their innocence due to being, as Prahlad Maharaj said, educated in the regular schools and colleges of this world. And they become contaminated. From that, just above the age of 5. So, you know, Prahlad Maharaj is speaking when he's just below 5 years of age to his classmates, the sons of the other senior administration officers of the government of Hiranyakashipu, ministers' sons, and so forth. So Prahlad is speaking through a purity of innocence. He doesn't know what is fear. He doesn't know what is
fear.
So therefore, he doesn't have to be fearless. So that's the consciousness of a resident of the spiritual world. And he knows the mighty, you could say, strength and the mighty position, you know, of his father. He knows that. But he doesn't know what is fear, and therefore he doesn't have to be fearless or fearful. That's the consciousness of a resident of the spiritual world. So it is very clear that we all have passed through that age from the birth up to 5 and now beyond. We are sitting here. So, you know what to do, you know, we are still not below 5 years of age, you know. And I'm almost 60 years of age, and everyone's about 5 years of age here, so what to do? In other words, we cannot really apply that from the age of below 5 years over, you know, to take to devotional service. We cannot really apply it right now. So how to practically apply this? Do not let that happen to your children and grandchildren. That's all. That's how you practically apply. At the same time, any sort of samskara or any impression that one receives from the day one is born to the age of before 5, that carries you in your actions and your nature for the rest of your life. For the rest of your life. Like if a child has a bad experience by seeing the mother and father fighting with each other at the age of 3, that carries with them for the rest of their life. So we have to be so careful and cautious in front of the children prior to their turning 5 years of age. Very careful, because it carries for the rest of their life. And as the child's body grows up into, you know, you could say juvenile age and, you know, youth and then young adult, that thing carries going on. What's wrong with? But you should ask, what did you do wrong that the child got this impression up to 5 years of age? You did something and the child is reacting in such a way. It's very difficult to pinpoint what you have done also in relation to the child to get this particular type of samskara. So therefore, a Prahlad Maharaj Maharaj is advising him. Very beautiful verse. That as soon as the child enters 5 years of age, you know, there is a training for the boys that is called brahmacharya. And there's a training for the girls, Prabhupada said, which is called chastity. For the brahmacharya it's called celibacy, and for the girls it's called chastity. It's one and the same word. But, you know, it's relative to a particular type of physiopsychological nature for male and female form for boy and girl. Chastity for the girls and celibacy for the boys. So Prahlad Maharaj is encouraging this. And he's a Maharaj at 5 years of age. See? But his father is not called Maharaj. You know? He's just Hiranyakashipu. You know? So this is Prahlad. He's telling us this is what should be done. So, but that's also not possible because we are not 5 years of age and we cannot get any brahmacharya training or brahmacharini training for the girls from 5 years old because we are beyond that, sitting right in this room. So how to practically apply that also in our own lives? Because we may come into Krishna consciousness when we are like 20, 25, 30 or 40 years of age or more. We're not 5 years of age to get that kind of training. So how to practically apply that in the present situation of where we are now. When that question was asked to Srila Prabhupada, he said that at least if you're still a young adult and you're not married, you shouldn't be married until you are trained as a responsible husband-to-be and you're trained as a responsible wife-to-be. See? You shouldn't even consider who you are marrying. You shouldn't even consider that. You should consider how can you be trained to be a responsible wife and a responsible husband. You should consider that first. Okay? Why? Because if you're already considering to marry a particular young man or young woman, but after the training you may change your mind of marrying somebody else because you feel you have been trained but she's not sufficiently trained. Or she feels that she is sufficiently trained, but he's just not taking the training seriously. So I can't marry him. So better not to make the decision of who you marry. You better make the decision after you get trained who you marry. See? So that's one category of persons. The second category, they are already engaged to be married, but they haven't been trained. So before you get married, get trained. Which is like kind of not the best thing, but you already have committed to each other to be married. The third thing is that they are already married. And they may even be parents and have children and they come to Krishna consciousness. So how to get some training for them? So in another program earlier last week, you know, one Mataji and a Prabhu, and they have two children, you could see. So here Prahlad Maharaj is saying, and his Prabhupada is saying, Harinama, 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 Eva Kevalam, Kalonas, Thevanas, Thevagatira, that we should chant the holy name of the Lord. So the initial training that is meant to be self-responsible, you're meant to be self-responsible. Because yesterday I said that when you're hungry, somebody else cannot eat for you. Similarly, when you chant your 16 rounds, others cannot chant your 16 rounds for you. See? So the initial training must come to actually chant the holy name of the Lord. But then, to actually chant the holy name of the Lord, one requires a support system. Just that activity alone, which is the foundation or basis. Just like yesterday, yesterday, the day before, our Mahanishinga Prabhu, I was chanting with him, and then he recorded my chanting. See? And then he reminded me today, which is a wonderful thing, that that's the kind of support that he reminded me today that, you know, Maharaj, I think you're missing one syllable in the beginning. And then he played the recording. So there are two ways. One is I may be able to hear, but he may not be able to hear even after recording. But it's true, I may have been missing one syllable. I was saying, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna, Krishna. I didn't say Hare Krishna, I said Hare Krishna, Krishna. Something like that. Something? Yeah. So it is a wonderful thing. You know? It's a wonderful thing. That's called Trinadapi Sunechena Tarorapi Sunechena. That somebody can remind you of how to nicely chant. It's very good. Remind you how to nicely chant. So I really appreciate that because, you know, very rarely people try to correct me. But if somebody corrects me, this is my greatest joy and my best friend because he's helping me. See? So therefore, even to chant Hare Krishna, we all need support. Not just for a few years. We need support all the time. Until the last moment of leaving this body with the last breath. We need support all the time. So I was in this program a few days, like early last week. And this Mataji asked the question, Maharaj, you know, you are emphasizing that we should chant the holy name in the morning. But you know, I have two children. And this husband of mine, you know, he is very demanding. You know, I need to make his lunch back and, you know, and so forth. See? I have to take care of the children, send them to school, come back, you know. It's difficult. It's very difficult. So then I explained to her what Srila Prabhupada said. Srila Prabhupada said that then you have to do two things before 10 o'clock in the morning. You have to chant your minimum 16 rounds and hear or read Srimad Bhagavat. So she was happy. See? But then I said also that that generally, you know, when I joined in the early 80s, you know, before that, during Prabhupada's time, you know, when we joined, you have to stay in the temple. To stay in the temple. There's no such thing as being a devotee in the congregation. There's no such thing. You have to stay in the temple. So it is very easy to practice Krishna consciousness when you stay in the temple because you have a morning program. So now, those who are based in the congregation and who are even initiated, maybe even second initiated, they don't have that training. They don't have that training, practically nil. They didn't even get trained before they even got married. If they wasn't married, then they joined. Practically no training. Yeah. So I suggested to her and her family, and also in another program, I said, within two programs, that, you know, you should go to a local Hare Krishna temple on a Friday evening with your husband and two children and book into one guest room and then go back home on Sunday afternoon after the Sunday program. So you'll have a good dose of two mornings of a good sadhana from 4:30 in the morning till up to breakfast at 9 o'clock. Get some training. And nobody is going to train you you have to apply voluntary force to just follow the morning program with everybody. So it's a very self-revealing and self-healing process. You just go with the flow of the morning program. Yeah. And then during the day on Saturday and on Sunday, if you don't work, you can do some service in the temple. Make some garlands or do some weed cleaning from the garden. So some service, you know? Yeah. And also make sure you put your cell phone off. Switch it off Friday evening, I'm in temple. And then switch it on Sunday evening when you go back. But you may not feel like switching it on. Because you've got this high dosage of being Krishna conscious for practically 2 full days and nights. So get some training, get into it. You don't have to even have to sign up or just go and stay in the temple. I mean, most of our temples, the bigger temples, they have a nice guest room. You may have to pay a little something, but sometimes you don't need to pay because you're doing a lot of service. That's how come stay. If you're seconding, oh, we need some pujaris, let these other pujaris go out and they should do that service like that. See? So you gotta have these guest facilities for the householders to come, because most of our devotees, the congregation, they had no or very little training even before they got initiated in terms of this. What Prahlad Maharaj is saying, supported by Srila Prabhupada, you know, in the Prabhupada. And Prahlad Maharaj said you should be trained from 5 years of age. But that's not practical because we come on young adult age to Krishna consciousness. So you will find that those who lived in temples, you know, men and women, and they have this natural feeling for the morning program called Sadhana Bhakti and chanting their rounds. When they get married, they definitely make better husbands and better wives. They definitely become better parents as father and mother. Definitely, you can easily see it because they had some training. Live in the temple 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, to get some training. Training means nobody trained you, you just followed the morning program, did service and so forth. You take that same kind of mood of the mandir. Mandir. Man means consciousness or mentality. Dira means sober. Mandir. You take it into your grihastha. Grihastha means home. So you convert your home into a mandir, because you were living in mandir. You take that same consciousness and go back to home, and you make that mandir. So mandir means, dira means to become sober in your mentality, your consciousness, or man. That's how powerful it is. So therefore it is extremely important to allow yourself by your own voluntary force to get some training. It's not too late that you're 5 years now, and, you know, now you're not 5 years yet and, you know, gone beyond that. It's not so late. So take full advantage of it. I know here in Soho Street they don't have such facility for you to stay as like a guest room with your families, even if you have children, but it's a nice thing they do have. It helps the congregation, it helps consciousness building, and it even helps devotees to come and do service voluntarily. Imagine you have somebody whole Saturday and practically all of Sunday to do service. That's a lot of the service, devotional service you're getting out of. So it's very, very important. If you've not been trained from the birth to age of 5 and beyond, try to get some training as far as you can. Are you okay? Alright. We'll have a little extra time again for questions and comments today. anyone? Worry? Anything? No, not question, some words of wisdom.
Yes.
I was thinking the same as living in a temple, we're quite privileged that we get a japa period.
Mm-hmm.
And that's often a struggle for devotees in the congregation because they never get a chance to chant with other devotees.
Can you hear at the back? Murli, you just turn around and scream a little bit.
We're speaking the other day how devotees in a temple, they get good opportunity to have a japa period and chant with other devotees. A lot of devotees in the congregation, they don't often get this opulence. So I was stressing that, or kind of emphasizing the need to take part in japa retreats.
It doesn't work so well.
No?
I do japa shraya courses, I know how this works.
And I was kind of, or at least spend one day a week with the
Everyone knows you go to a japa retreat, it's very nice, you get fired up, and after 1 week, what happens?
Back.
Everyone knows this. Even I know it. But I teach japa ashraya. I don't go on a retreat.
Japa ashraya, can you explain?
Yeah, when you experience it, you'll know. It takes 4 days to explain, to attend one. I'm doing one in. What's it? They say reading or writing?
Reading.
It's like it must be in a devotional place as best as we can. Strictly on Prabhupada's instructions. I think Prabhupada Priya, you attended one.
Mm-hmm.
We've improved it.
Okay.
In my So the best thing is that you take the consciousness of a mandir into your home, because that's where you live every day. You don't live in the mountains when you go for a japa retreat for 5 days or 1 week. You live in your home. It has to become your very existence, not temporarily. So go ahead. You were saying something else?
Yeah, that's basically.
That's basically.
I think I can.
Okay. So it's very important that you don't work on Saturday and Sunday. Maybe if you don't work on Sunday, come on a Saturday evening. You have to stay the night over. You have to stay the night before to enter them, to go for the morning mangala. You have to do that. You have to do that. Of course, sometimes on odd days, maybe you take rest very late because you have to attend to devotees. That's not different. But your regular sadhana should try to be there every day, at least to do your chanting of japa. So, we live most of our time in temples, but if there's no place in a temple, we live with some devotee household home. That's fine. But you live most of the time at home. So you should come, to the temple, live on a Friday evening and leave on a Sunday night. That dosage, what you get, you'll slowly see, you'll introduce it nicely in your own home, that full morning program. I'll give you some examples of how this wonderfully works. See? If you go to East Africa, say like the temple in Nairobi, the devotees of the congregation who have regular jobs also. Yeah. And they come for a morning program. At least about 40, 50 of them in Nairobi from the congregation. They come for the Mangalarti. And they'll chant all the way around, and then before greeting the deities, they'll go home, change and come back, take darshan and go. But they'll complete the rounds. It's simple. You go to Juhu Temple, you go to Chaupati Temple, you go to Mira Road, you go to Delhi Temple. You'll see all these congregations coming in the morning into the temple. See? So sometimes I ask them, if you don't make it a temple, no, I have it in my morning program and I must have. And very nicely, you know, Murli Manohar was saying, it's a spiritual opulence. It's an opulence. It's an opulence to actually have this great privilege of chanting japa in the morning, attending the morning prayer. It's an opulence. You had your hand up. Tell us.
Hare Krishna Maharaj.
Hare Krishna.
I wanted to ask, it's very nice to be able to go to morning program, to associate with devotees and just go through the whole process. But if we have deities at home that we need to take care of as well, then how can we, is it good to do deity worship at home?
Are you talking from a personal level or from a general level?
Personal.
Yes. The first thing is that in order to have deities and worship them, it has to come through the order of the disciplic succession. You can't whimsically take one Govardhan, Sheila, and whimsically have Golnitai, and whimsically have Radha Krishna. It's a good show. See? It's like, you know, well, if you haven't taken permission and already got deities, go and get permission. Do that. You know, it's like a mother and father that's bringing a child into this world. You know? They have very nice 3 meals a day, but the child, no, you take 1 meal a day, I'll give you fruits, I'll go all day, come back. Will you do that to the child? Right? You know, by the mutual consent of the mother and father, they brought a child into this world. See? So should they neglect the child? Yeah. So similarly, by the mutual consent of higher authority and yourself, you bring Gaur-Nitai. You bring Radha Krishna, Jagannath Balada, Subhadra. You bring them. You have to take care of them. Srila Prabhupada used to say that although Krishna is known as Janardhan, Jana means all living entities. Ardhan means to nourish. Although Krishna supplies everything for every living entity to exist and subsist even in the material world, he's Janardhan. But Krishna is not Janardhan to Mother Yasoda. See? So Prabhupada says that Mother Yasoda feels, if I don't feed this boy, he will die. See? Now, if you have a child at home and you don't feed the child, he will leave. He will leave. That means die. So you have deities, but you're eating in outside restaurants, you're enjoying yourself, these poor deities only get fruits in the morning once. What kind of... And you know, and Gaur-Nitai are very naughty boys. They're very...
Naughty?
Yeah, you have to be with them all the time, otherwise they'll do something naughty. They'll leave you. I don't want to stay, doesn't feel like home. They're eating so much, they're buying chocolates for their own children, while they're not taking care of us. But they'll leave. It's a very deep thing. You don't play around with deities. It's a nice question you ask for everyone, because they also have deities, some of them. Have I answered your question?
So just continuing from that question,
tell me your name again.
I'm Saranya.
Oh yeah, I remember last year, yesterday.
Yeah. dating.
And somebody's name was Paranya.
Paranya.
Okay, Saranya.
His deity worship?
In Grihastha Ashram meant to... No. In the Kali Yuga, she's asking deity worship in the Grihastha Ashram. In the Kali Yuga is Kali Kala Nama Rupa Krishna Avatar. In the Kali Yuga, Krishna is descended in the form of the... Form of the Nama Rupa. Form, Nama Rupa, holy name. Hare Krishna,
Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
It's nice to have deities, but it's even more nice to chant japa in the morning. So first one must confirm and realize that one should chant the holy names. After one is fixed in chanting the holy names in the morning, at home or coming to the temple, then one can consider some form of the Lord to come through the mercy of the holy name.
Is it meant to occupy your time so much that you can't do anything else?
You know, it's meant to occupy your time. That's not the reason for deity worship. It's like, you know, you don't give them so much time from Monday to Friday because you work. Then you give them more time on Saturday and Sunday. But the traditional Krishna conscious culture is that women don't work. Girls don't work. Then you can have deities. Because the deities, you know, you eat breakfast, they eat breakfast before you. Because you take prasad. And before you take lunch, they offer the lunch. Before you take dinner, you offer. So they home. They stay home. See? But this conforming idea in the Kali Yuga, you know, woman must work. It's too ingrained, it's too conditioned. See? It leads to like the suffering condition of single mothers, leads to neglect children on the street, put them in orphanages, so many things at least. So you're asking a question, but that question has ramifications of what is actually deity worship at home. See? The mother or the wife takes care of the deities all day. She chants around and sews nice outfits, make garlands, offer them boga, becomes prasad. See? See, deities are our children in a way. Just as Mother Yasoda and Nanda Maharaj should have children in the form of cows. The cows live with them. So the same way, just as the cows lived with them, Krishna and Balaram lived with them. So they're part of the family. Yeah, but they're not like just metal or some brass or marble or wood. No, they're part of the family. Are you okay?
Yeah.
So I'm speaking about the traditional, natural Krishna conscious culture. Everything else is completely unnatural. So therefore, your question leads to so many ramifications of what is the prerequisites first to have a deity at home. See? And we should not stoop down to Hinduism. Hinduism is nice, it supports Bhagavad Gita. Most Indians are Hindus and they support us, that's nice. At the same time, Krishna consciousness is above upadis, is above being Hindu, Christian, Muslim or Jew. Although we support Hindus, Hindus support us, that's nice. See? Like in Hinduism, they'll invite the deity home, but they'll have a paid brahmana to do the puja. See? The Mother Yashoda does not do that. She personally bathes Krishna. She doesn't have some servant coming bathing Krishna and Balaram. So that's not deity worship. That's beyond deity worship. And Prabhupada said, you should worship this deity in such a way that one day Krishna will speak to you. Hey. And Prabhupada says like that. You getting it? Yeah. So I'll give you another thing to consider. Yeah. Do you know that when the husband and wife, or the mother and father, when both work, money is not enough? Money is? But you know, only when the father works or the husband works, money will always be enough. We think, Maharaj, are you going pugla? It doesn't make sense. It makes sense. Try it, it makes sense. How many of you disagree? How many of you agree? You getting it? Yeah. Do you know that when the mother, when she's not at home and she goes to work, it's a house. It's a house. It's not a home. It's not a
home.
So when the children go to school, the mother is not at home. She's at work. You understand? So when they come home, the children, they come into a
house.
It's impersonal. They're not coming to your home. Means mother. Home means wife. They're not there. So they come to walls. They'll have some nanny. It's not really paid person to take. How can you pay a person to take care of your children? Pay. It's a job for them. It's a
job.
They tolerate the children, and after they go into the, they leave the house. Whew.
It's true.
Getting it? So in the same way, when you invite Radha and Krishna, or Gaur Nithai, or any form of the Lord in deity form, they have to live in a
home,
not in a house. How much more they should live in a home? Lord. Very important. That's called deity worship. That's called, that's how Mother Yashoda and Nanda Maharaj take care of Krishna and Balaram. Nice question.
What is it?
Bless him to go first.
on the point about the mother not being in the home, being in the home, being a house, and my sister turned around to me once when my mother was dying. She took about 2 years to die, and she says she looked after her. And she says that's the first time I've ever known my mother. And that's because my mother was always out at work.
Yes. It's actually very, it's very traumatic for the children. Very traumatic. They suffer. because they come to a house, they don't come to a home. You can give them everything. You can give them the latest cell phones, all the gadgets, give them a five-star bedroom in there. You give them everything. They're not happy. Because the spirit soul is hankering for one thing. Mutual love and affection. That you cannot buy materially. That comes from a mother's heart. Or from a wife's heart. It comes like that. This is Krishna conscious culture. We have the best role models. They're not even role models, they're natural parents of Krishna and Balaram, Madhu Rohini, Madhu Yasoda, Nandama. Such a nice role models. The best, Goloka. And who's the other children? The cows. The?
Cows.
And the cows, they have to live with the Vaishya community. Krishna is a farmer's son. You know? And you know, in the material world, he's a farmer's boy, you know, he's from the farm, you know, it's like a degraded thing. I'm living in London, in a city. Rascal, suffering like anything else. Can't even breathe fresh air. The more the air is contaminated, the more expensive the place to live in. You know that? It's such a paradox in the material world. You know, the air is more polluted in London, right? Right? But if you go up north, say to Rugby or Coventry, you can buy a six-bedroom house for the price of a one bachelor's flat in London, isn't it? And the air is freer to breathe. So where the air is more contaminated, this is a more expensive place to live. It's complete paradox. It's complete dead. Diametrically opposite. So therefore the cows, they are also part of the household, especially if you are a Vaishya mercantile person, you know? Business. So you keep some cows. Agriculture, you keep some cows. But the cows should not be put in a cow protection program. Where you put 100 cows in 1 acre of land. And in the name of cow protection you collect so much money. Go puja this, that. So what is this? You should teach the devotees who are inclined and have the heart for cows to take care of cows as their own children. As their own
children.
Beautiful. You know, Madhu Yasoda and Nanda Maharaj, you know, they have an inner courtyard and they have an outer courtyard. So the rooms on the outer courtyard, Nanda Maharaj and his cowherd hands live. And on the inner courtyard, Madhu Rohini, Madhu Yasoda and Krishna and Balaram, the two naughty boys, live. So the smaller calves, right? They stay in the inner courtyard. And the grown-up, you know, cows and bulls, they stay on the outer courtyard. And some of the grown-up cows come also in the inner courtyard with the children. Very beautiful way. See? We should be protecting cows, that's clear. But we should preach to one cow killer so that so many cows can be protected in the future. If you change one cow killer, right, who's slaughtering thousands of cows a year, and you change him and make him a devotee, then what happens? You're saving so many
cows.
You have to preach to them. But actual cow protection is not to protect them. It's natural for a Vaishya, not just being a banker or something or a businessman. He should have some nice place outside the country and keep some cows as his own children, just as he has other children that's born to him, his sons and daughters. It's beyond protecting cows, they're members of the family. Namo Brahmanya Devaya. Go Brahmanya Dayaja. Before you respect and take, guidance and transfer knowledge from the Brahmanas, you have to take care of cows. Therefore, Krishna's personal planet is named after the cows. What's the planet called?
Goloka.
Goloka. Surabhi Abhipalayanta. They are freely grazing. They don't know what is fear. You don't have to be fearful or fearless. It's not freely grazing. Carefree. Surabhi Abhipalayanta. So you will notice that when you ask me a question, I give a completely different answer. Not something what you expect to hear. Like deities. She's asking also about deities. Krishna consciousness is very deep and very personal for everything. Everything. It's not a grand show. It's not about marketing. It's not about outreach, 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 and no inreach. The more you reach in, you become more personal. Outreach automatically comes. That's what we have to do. Serving the deities, serving the cows, serving the devotees. Other questions? Can you turn around and...
It's often seen like if you give the culture to around 5 years you give the culture to a children, small, as a small child, you give the culture and everything. But still after so many years we have seen that they deviate in sense at times. And
that's not true.
And they are not taking
that's not true.
Seriously Krishna
consciousness. That is not true.
And on the contrary.
That is not true. You have children?
A son.
How old is he?
12.
It's not true. If you expand your heart, you'll see another boy also as your son. Why don't you say that? If you walk down the street, right? If you walk down the street, you'll see another 12-year-old boy begging. He's a beggar, he's a boy. But you have a 12-year-old son too, right? Yeah. So you'll ignore him when you walk. You go further down, you'll see another 12-year-old boy. Hey, what are you doing here? You realize this is your brother's son. This is your brother's? Hey, come. Oh, my father kicked me out of the house. I did some nonsense. Oh, come stay with me. But why didn't you do that to the first boy? Because your consciousness is prejudiced. It is?
Prejudiced.
Prejudiced. So you're attributing something. This is for everyone, and he's asking a nice question. So you're attributing that I have to help my son. Yes, you should do that. You should not ignore neglect. But your heart is not expanding. You know? Not is not
expanding.
To see everyone as part and parcel of the Supreme Father. And you'll always be in anxiety about your own family if your heart does not expand. There's nothing wrong with your son. You don't try to change your son. You should change for him to change. Never try to change others. You make the change and automatically others will change. So whatever samskaras we give our children up to the age of 5, positive Krishna conscious impressions or samskaras, even if they go a little wayward in their teenage years and so forth, it'll still save them when they turn over 21, 24, 25. It'll save them, they'll come back. They will turn around, come back. Why? Because it takes a whole village to bring up a child. It takes a whole village to bring up a child. You gave your son the best samskaras up to 5 years age. You didn't expand your heart to help other people because you're a possessor and you're prejudiced. See? So you have to expand that. That means village. That means
village.
When your son goes to school in his teenagehood, he has peer pressure, this, that, he gets all sorts of nonsense, you know, sort of in his head due to electronic media, due to like peer pressure in the school, you know, his teacher is not the best role model, you know, that type of, you understand the point? Yeah. So he gets all that, but he's going to pass through that. See? But in a village, he's not going to have that. At the same time, we should not keep our children in a protective bubble. In a protective bubble. Once a bubble bursts, oh, what's that? Then they go to the extreme sense gratification. See? You have to teach them both vidya and avidya, you know? In terms of. You have to teach them how to deal with this world, and you have to show them what is higher and what is lower, and they make their choice. See? But for lack of not having our own village, right? And when they leave the village and go into the city to preach, that's what Prabhupada wants the householders to do. Live on the farm communities, but come to the city to preach and go back and live in the farm community. So when the children come with you to the city, and I get headache here when I come, you know, so much traffic, so much noise, I want to go back. And they see how people are suffering, you know, suffering, anxiety, smoking, this, that. So when they go to the village, there's no stress and there's no depression. City has stress and depression. They'll see that. So you don't keep them in a protective bubble, you keep them as missionaries. Yes? When they grow up, they're going to preach to the people in the cities. But you have to expand the heart. See? So I'll give you one example of how you can expand your heart. Very simple. Doesn't require highfalutin internal realization of Krishna consciousness. Doesn't require sadhaka, sadhana. Doesn't require vijnan, realization. Doesn't require. Very simple. See, you know that Janmashtami is coming, right? And you know that your son may want a new outfit to wear, go to the temple. New dhoti, whatever, right? You know that, right? Or Janmashtami, buy a new dress, we'll go to temple. So you know that you're going to spend some money for that dress. Say like you'll spend like £50. So why can't you go to your neighbor who's like favorable to Krishna consciousness and he also has a 12-year-old son? And you tell him, look, I am going shopping with my son, but I want to take your son for shopping. And I know you don't normally go to the temple, but I also want to buy him something new to wear so that I can take him for Janmashtami. You're not preaching to them. You're not? But you are. And you know they can't afford new clothes very easily, right? So you take that boy with you and your son. And so whatever you buy for your son, it's equally valuable of the cost for that boy. So you spend £25 on each instead of the £50 on your son. So you broaden the heart. Now who sees that? Who sees it? No, your son.
Oh, okay.
Who sees what you're doing?
Your son.
Your son. And Janmashtami comes, you take this boy to the temple, but you know we also can come with our car. Okay? We'll all go together by two-wheeling my car behind. You take that family with you. They come Janmashtami night, and that boy, he got a Janmashtami outfit. So he asks, when's the next festival? I'll wear the same thing and come. Radha Astami. You expand the heart. Super. And you're wondering why my boy is not Krishna conscious. No, he is. You have to bring it out in him. He has to expand his own heart. By doing that. Are you okay? We have some minutes, anyone? One more question. What's in your consciousness? Yes.
That's a difficult question.
Tell us.
I was just reflecting on how...
Can you... Turn around.
This way.
Loudly.
I was just reflecting on...
Mauritius?
Yeah.
Arjun's son.
Yeah.
Turn around. Loudly.
I was just reflecting on how... On the truth of the statement you just made on how basically the right way parents look after their children in Krishna consciousness, and you do see that practically happening in devoted communities where sometimes the wrong thing is done. We try to like preach to the children, but instead of giving them a Krishna conscious impression so that they can ultimately make the choice themselves to be devotees.
Yeah.
So yeah, that was going in my mind, I was like thinking about
it. Prabhupada said example is better than precept. It's all coming from Prahlad Maharaj. He didn't even have a temple. He's living with his father. Hiranyakashi. The Prabhupada wrote one letter to one disciple, you know? And he said something like, now she wrote and she said, you know, my parents are giving me such a hard time, you know, that since I take to this Krishna consciousness and I haven't joined the temple yet. She was writing her letter. I could gather what she wrote to Prabhupada, you know. My parents are giving me such a hard time, I can't chant properly, they don't follow the principles, but I want to do all this. Srila Prabhupada, what do I do? And Srila Prabhupada wrote back, you know, Hiranyakashipu wanted to kill his own son, Prahlad, because he is a devotee. But at least I think your parents are not going to kill you. And she was pacified. You see, the most important thing is...
No, it's feeding into the speakers. Huh? The mic is feeding into the speakers. If it's turned like that, it will help.
That means they have to sort out the sound system. Not me.
No, no, it's the way the mic is positioned.
Okay, that's better. Okay. You know, we should know one thing. That we should not preach to our family members who are not devotees. Right? Because you make them feel that they are inferior to you. See? What you should do, you should show them that since I've taken to this process of Krishna consciousness, can't you see I'm a better daughter? Can't you see I'm a better son? Can't you see I'm a better mother? I'm a better father? See? They should not feel that this process of Krishna consciousness is taking away a member of my family in that role of father, mother, husband, wife, son or daughter. Show them how Krishna consciousness is making me a better, more worthy member of my family. You know, Papa, I'm your daughter. Aren't you proud of me that I used to do these other things? Now I'm not doing because I'm doing this. Papa, am I becoming a better daughter? Yeah, you are better. Yes. So that will make them become devotees. When you become a more worthy member of the family. They don't see you as devotee. They say, oh, I'm losing my daughter here. I'm losing my wife, you know. She spends more time in the temple than spends with me. What is wrong with that? Go. You getting it? So Krishna consciousness is not about breaking up families. Krishna consciousness enhances family values in a greater way in the family. Your hand is tired.
I was just wondering on what you're speaking just now. Does that mean that, like I live with my parents at the moment as well.
That's fine.
Yeah, but does that mean that I should, like, I love spending time with my mum and my dad and my brother and stuff. But does it mean that I should reduce time that I spend, like, maybe coming to the temple or chanting or?
No, that's not what we are saying.
Yeah, because we are saying
you should not reduce your consciousness as a son and being more of a devotee to them. Understand? So even if it means spending more time with them will make them more favorable to see you as a better son, that's better. That is better. Because ultimately, you want to make them favorable to Krishna consciousness, even if they do not practice, but they are not in your way. You with me? Yeah. So somehow or the other, that should be there. Somehow or the other. That should be. And they don't really want to see you as a bad son or a bad boy anymore. They just want to see you, how you're becoming better by what you're doing presently than what you were before. So you're showing your mother, your father and your other siblings that you're a better brother or a better son. That's the principle to follow. It's like if you used to spend with your mother and father almost, you know, every Sunday in the park. Don't ignore that. Don't neglect that. you still go with them to the park. You understand? And then one day you can tell them, look, I can still be with you, can we all go to the Hare Krishna temple instead of the park? But if you don't come with me, then I will.
Take your hand off.
I can't put, there's no switch off here.
No.
Okay. So it's very, very important that when you tell your mother and father, like an example, you know, we won't go to the park and they cannot go to the temple, they'll say no. And you'll tell them, look, if you don't wish to go to the temple, that's fine. I'll stay with you in the park. You go along with the flow. And then the next week, your mother will say, you know, last week we felt really bad. You wanted to go to the temple, but then you stayed with us. Okay, let's go to the temple. Mm-hmm. It happens like that. See? You have to go with the flow and then slowly turn the tide. But don't go with the flow and go with the flow.
That's the danger.
It's not a danger. It's not a danger. You have to know how slowly to turn the tide. It works. And in order to slowly turn the tide, it's not you going to do it. You have to chant minimum 16 rounds of japa first and then slowly turn the tide. And that means tesham satata yuktanam bhajate priti purvakam tadami buddhi yogaptam yanama upayantite. That Krishna will give you the necessary intelligence, buddhi yoga, to turn the tide. But don't threaten the family members by threatening to give up the relationship with them. As a mother, father, husband, wife, son, that is very bad. Are we okay? All right, we have to conclude. It's already 8 o'clock. We'll meet you tomorrow. Same time, around 6:15. We'll take care of time before I come. Because we want to avoid that congestion charge. 6 o'clock. That's a lot of money, eh? 11 pounds. Congestion charge. Huh? All right, so we'll meet you tomorrow. Srila Prabhupada ki
jai.
Shri Prahlad Maharaj ki
jai.
Anantakuri Vaishnav Vrinda ki
jai.
Natai Go Premande.
His Holiness Prihat Bhagavat Maharaj ki
jai.